Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. On the agenda tonight, we're going back to 1971. We're going to be taking a look at Johnny Cash, and he's going to be playing through Man in Black. And this is the first time that anybody heard this song because it hadn't been released yet. It would have been released maybe the next month and on the album a couple of months after this performance. But let's get into this and see how Johnny gets on.
Well, you wonder why I always dress in black. Why you never see bright colors on my back. And why does my appearance always have a somber tone? Well, there's a reason for the things that I have on. I wear the black for the poor and the beaten down, living in the hopeless, hungry side of town. And I wear it for the prisoner who has long paid for his crime, but still is there because he's a victim of the times. I wear the black for those who've never read or listened to the words that Jesus said about the road to happiness through love and charity. Why, you'd think he's talking straight to you and me. Well, we're doing mighty fine, I do suppose, in our streak of lightning cars and fancy clothes. But just so we're reminded of the ones who are held back, up front there ought to be a man in black. I wear it for the sick and lonely old, for the reckless ones whose bad trip left them cold. I wear the black in mourning for the lives that could have been. Each week we lose 100 fine young men. And yes, I wear it for the thousands who have died, believing that the Lord was on their side. And I wear it for another 100,000 who have died, believing that we all were on their side. Well, there's things that never will be right, I know, and things need changing everywhere you go. But till we start to make a move to make a few things right, you'll never see me wear a suit of white. I'd love to wear a rainbow every day to tell the world that everything's okay. But maybe I can carry off a little darkness on my back till things are brighter. I'm the man in black.
And there we have it, a standing ovation, and there were a lot of shots just looking at the crowd, sometimes more shots of the crowd than we had of Johnny, but it showed you how engaged they were in the message that Johnny was sending to them through the lyrics of the song. And this is what Johnny Cash was all about in terms of making a connection with an audience, but playing country music that was deep and had a serious undertone in there and serious messages. And I did mention in the other video that I did with Roy Clark and Johnny Cash when they're playing Folsom Prison Blues, a lot of things about Johnny and the way that the outlaw country was that opposite side of the spectrum to the other sound that was coming out of Nashville that was very polished. And Johnny was one of those guys that what you saw was what you got. The image that Johnny had suited the sound that he made to a T, because he wasn't trying to be anybody else. It was just him. And you either liked it or you didn't didn't like it, but he didn't care. And that's the point. He would just make his music, and if people like it, great. But if they don't, he's not going to pretend to be somebody else. And that's a mistake that a lot of people make in the music industry, is not making music that they want to make, or trying to look a particular way, or trying to make music that they think people want to hear. That's never the way to do it. And guys like Johnny Cash show you exactly the route to go down. When an artist is true to themselves musically, it means that everything that they write, the way that they look, and everything about their personality, the whole music and their personality become one, because they're not pretending to be something else. They're not being told by somebody at a record label to look a particular way or to write a particular way. And that is what you got from Johnny Cash. It was just a personality and the music are all blended into one. Also, by keeping his musical integrity, it means that when Johnny Cash sings, he's not trying to sound like any other singer. And it's a massive part of his sound. He's not reaching for high C's here. He's just using the voice that he's got, because that's all he needs in order to get his message across throughout his songs, throughout the lyrics. And it's another mistake a lot of people make, is trying to sound like other singers. Working at your voice is fine, trying to increase your range, but in terms of trying to change your tone to sound exactly like your favorite singer, the problem is the closer you get to the sound of that singer, the more you're going to be seen as almost an impersonator rather than an individual artist. And Johnny is another great example of a guy who used to listen to gospel music and listen to some of those gospel singers and then have a listen to Johnny Cash singing. He is not what you would class a gospel singer. And that is because he's been influenced by that music and by those singers, but he's applying his own individual artistic expression to the music that he's being influenced by. He's not trying to copy exactly what he's hearing. He's just taking that on board and then putting it into his own sound, which is what music is all about. All the rules still apply. When we're looking at this performance, the dynamic changes. Johnny's obviously playing and singing at the same time, but dynamically his vocal is going to change when he starts talking rather than singing melodically. So you get that totally different dynamic going on there, but then musically as well, the way that right before the end, we are full in with the band, we're really leaning into the sound, but then we take a total step back to then finish the track. It's just making that journey more interesting, so that we've gone to different places, but you could see from the crowd here, everyone's totally engaged, because the journey is just as much musically as it is lyrically. Everyone's listening to every word, and all of the music in the background is almost the undercurrent to the message and the lyrics that are on top of that. As I said, I did feature a video of Johnny playing with Roy Clark, so you guys can check that out if you want to. I don't want to repeat anything that I said in that video in this one, but talking about Johnny Cash and his personality and the way that he was, and not faking anything, you can tell that his words, the lyrics that he used in his songs, were coming from a deep place and were part of his life experience. It wasn't him trying to write something that he'd made up. It wasn't somebody else's story. And that was the attraction, and that's how he could get that connection with the audience, because you know that he was singing from the heart. He did have a really hard life from an early age. At the age of 5, he was picking cotton in the cotton fields with his family, and they'd sing whilst they worked. And at age 12, he went through a really traumatic time with his brother, because his brother went off for work and he got caught up in an unmanned table saw and got dragged into it, and he was almost cut in half and had to go to hospital, obviously. And unfortunately, he died a week after this. And at the time, the same day, Johnny said in his autobiography that he and his mother and the whole family had an uneasy feeling about the day. And his mum said to his brother Jack not to go to work, but to go fishing with Johnny. But Jack said that they couldn't afford to. He needed to go to work. So he went to work. And unfortunately, those events unfolded and he lost his brother at age 12. 6 years later, at the age of 18, this would have been 1950, he enlisted in the Air Force and was a Morse code operator. And he was intercepting transmissions by the Soviet Army. And in 1954 is when he was honorably discharged. So straight after leaving the Air Force, he visited Sun Records and auditioned for Sam Phillips. And I think initially he wasn't successful, but then the second time that he did, he was taken on and he signed a contract with Sun Records. And in 1955 is when he first started recording. And he had a massive hit with them, Folsom Prison Blues, which I mentioned was in that other video that I did that he plays with Roy Clark. But then he signed to Columbia Records in 1958, and then he had a massive hit with them, and that was called Don't Take Your Guns to Town. And the interesting thing was that the previous contract he had with Sun Records, they owned all of the music that he recorded with them. So into his Columbia contract, he had two albums coming out with two labels, because Sun Records was still releasing Johnny Cash music when he was releasing with Columbia. So it's a really rare situation to be in that you've got two albums coming out at the same time by the same artist from different labels. So because Johnny was such a prolific writer, in 1960, he had three albums out. One of those was from Sun Records. The other two were from Columbia Records. And in 1963 is when it all kicked off, because he released his album called Ring of Fire, The Best of Johnny Cash. And that got to number one in the country charts. After that, the same year, he released Blood, Sweat and Tears. And that got to number 13. I just want to put into perspective the amount of success Johnny Cash had at this time, because from 1964 onwards, he had 14 albums in a row that all made it into the top 10 of the charts. And that started with the original Sun Sound of Johnny Cash, all the way up to the 1973 Any Old Wind That Blows. To put it into a broader perspective, from 1963 to 1979, he always had an album that was in the top 50 of the charts. A new album, I mean, every year he was releasing something and having albums released. It might be a collaboration, for example, that he did with June Carter, but he'd always have an album somewhere in the charts for that year that has been in the top 50. So throughout that period, we're talking 16 years in all, that Johnny Cash was always in the charts. Just while I'm mentioning June Carter, yes, that is the daughter of Mother Maybelle Carter, who you can find on this channel as well. So Mother Maybelle Carter was Johnny Cash's mother-in-law. But getting back to Johnny Cash, the success that he was having at this time, and also from 1969 to 1971 is when he had his own TV show. So this is exactly what we're looking at here, this performance. So he was in the public's consciousness the whole time, getting on TV as well. So he was selling massively in terms of his own music, the albums he is releasing, but also featuring other artists on his show, and also doing collaborations with other artists as well. Just quickly want to tell this story about the fishing trip that Johnny went on in 1965 with his nephew Jack, because a fire started and it's unclear as to how it started, but Johnny says that the car exhaust started it, and Jack seems to think that it was Johnny that started it, just trying to stay warm, and then he might have fallen asleep, or he wasn't entirely with it and didn't realize the fire was then out of control. But it was a massive fire. It destroyed 508 acres of forest and land, and it caused 49 out of 53 endangered California condors to leave the area. And Johnny Cash was sued by the federal government, and they won that case and were awarded $125,000. Fortunately, the California Condors are still around. They could have literally been wiped out by Johnny Cash. But for anybody concerned out there, as of 2017, there were 463 California Condors still living. So that was all fine. Johnny Cash didn't wipe out that whole species. He also had three hit albums with the Highwaymen. That's something that I mentioned in my other video. He sold over 90 million albums, making him one of the biggest selling artists of all time. He had that crossover appeal because he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but also the Gospel Music Hall of Fame. And just to put it out there as well, the 96 albums that I mentioned earlier, those were all produced in his 48-year career. So two albums a year, averaging. A prolific songwriter, his final two studio albums that he released in the year 2000, American 3, Solitary Man, that got to number 11 in the country charts, and then American 4, which was called The Man Comes Around, that was released in 2002, and that got to number 2 in the charts, in the country charts, but number 22 in the main charts in the USA as well. So right up until his passing in 2003 is when Johnny left us, and that was just 4 months after June had left. And I think June was such a massive part of Johnny's life that after she went, he felt like he didn't really have too much else to live for. So he passed on really soon after June did. But those two albums just go to show how prolific he was in terms of just releasing material throughout his career, but also material that is going to connect with people and sell a lot of copies because of that connection. Those last two albums were a great indicator of that. Also, before June passed away, she said to Johnny to keep writing, keep making music, and he definitely did. In the last 4 months of his life, he completed over 60 songs, so he kept writing right up until the end. And after his death, American 5, 100 Highways was released, and that got to number one in the US country charts, got to number one in the mainstream charts in the USA as well, and it got to number 9 here in the UK charts. But Johnny Cash, such a unique artist and one of the big names of country music. And when you think about his wife, June Carter, and June's mum, Mother Maybelle Carter, the amount of country music that they had under one roof and how successful they were, it was astounding to have that much success in that genre, just all under one roof. But Johnny was one of those artists that was something that it's all you can ask for from an artist, to be true to themselves and to just give you themselves when they play live and when they write. And that's certainly what you got with Johnny. What you saw was what you got. But thank you so much for suggesting this video for me to take a look at, and keep those suggestions coming in the comments below. Let me know what you guys think. And if you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. And I'll see you guys at the next one. Rock!